Pan profesor Tetsuo Kano. Pan profesor już przygotowuje się do swojego wystąpienia. Wybitny badacz, wybitny naukowiec, naukowiec światowej sławy, honorowy prezes Światowej Federacji Neurochirurgów, założyciel i prezes Azjatyckiego Kongresu Neurochirurgów, także założyciel i prezes Japońskiego Kongresu Chirurgii Nowotworów Mózgu. Profesor honorowy Fujita Health. Pan profesor mówić będzie o metodach leczenia śpiączki, ale będzie mówił o przeszłości, o teraźniejszości i o wyzwaniach przyszłości dla naukowców, którzy pracują w tej właśnie dziedzinie. Bardzo proszę.
May I start? Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I come from Japan. My name is Kano. I'm staying, I have been staying at this hospital, New University Hospital, Fujita Health University. It's located in Nagoya near Toyota Company. It has about 1,500 beds. The one of the most number of the patients to the university hospital in Japan. This is the founder, Professor Fujita. He passed away about 20 years ago. He was a very good organizer, but at the same time, he had three top name papers in Nature. Is there anyone who has three top name papers in Nature? I don't know. Anyway, there's nobody around me except Professor Fujita. This was the member of the Department of Neurosurgery. When I retired, the chief professor there are rather many members in our neurosurgical department. Now, maybe this is the same important, world is changing, and medical treatment is also changing. In Japan particularly, people want to detect asymptomatic disease for long healthy life. That's why nowadays in Japan, the so-called brain dog and body dog, it's so popular. The people who has no symptoms want to have this check once every 1 or 2 years. Like this, maybe you have the same examination in Poland, and heart, not only brain, heart, and so that body, to find out the early stage of the cancer. People cannot die so easily. You think this is happy? Generally speaking, we have more and more senior person, not only Japan, in the world. Maybe that is the same in your country. You know, in Japan, it's terribly increasing. The number of the senior person more than 65 years old. This is a very big problem for Japanese government. They must use huge tax money to take care of these patients. You know, the medical expense is terribly increasing. It's a big problem for the government. I don't know the situation in Poland, but in Japan, patients also changing. All patients have a lot of complaint against the doctors, nurses, everything. And then they say, don't do surgery so easily. You know, I am a neurosurgeon, so this is a big problem for the surgical side of the doctors. So nowadays in Japan, the so-called robot surgery is becoming very, very popular like this. And then robot surgery is very accurate, less invasive surgery, very safe surgery. So the people want to have this kind of surgery. But there's one problem. This machine is very, very expensive for the hospital to buy. So neurosurgeon must change now. Because when I was young, when I finished the surgery, okay, after this, rehabilitation people, doctors, must take care of the patient. I don't care. But nowadays, the patient do not allow it. You must take care for a long time, even after they discharge home. You know, the neurosurgeon is usually very busy. It's a big problem. But anyway, rehabilitation is changing. From the general rehabilitation to neuro rehabilitation. I'll talk a little bit about the present condition, situation of neuro rehabilitation in Japan. I'll tell you, there are some new treatment in Japan. You mentioned about transcranial magnetic stimulation also, dorsal column stimulation, transplantation of bone marrow stem cell, and robot suits. Transcranial magnetic stimulation. This is non-painful treatment for hemiplegia after stroke and head trauma. It finishes 15 minutes for one treatment, and the patient usually have 20 times, so it takes 2 weeks or 3 weeks. Then they go home. No pain for the patient at all. This is one of the patients, 70 years old, left side hemiparesis like this. So he had the transcranial magnetic stimulation like this. 2 months after this transcranial magnetic stimulation. But I don't say all the cases are effective. Some cases showed such the remarkable improvement. I'll show you one more case. She had a stroke. Please compare before and after. Before and after. Again, before and after. The movement becomes much, much better. No painful treatment. And also there are some talk about the stem cell treatment. We have done also the transplantation of bone marrow stem cell. It was developed by Professor Hommo in Japan, in Sapporo University. This is a stroke, mild stroke patient, before the treatment. Although he could walk, but a little bit difficult to walk. This is before treatment. He could not use the left hand well. And the stem cells were taken from the bone. Not so painful to take out the stem cells. And it's increased in culture. Then it's given back intravenously, intravenous injection. Again, not so big treatment, not so painful treatment. Please compare before and 2 weeks after. 2 weeks after. Now he can walk much better than before. 1 month after, and then discharge. Again, I must say, not in all cases. Robot suits is also becoming more and more popular. This is very nice, particularly for some difficulty of lower legs. It was developed by Professor Sankai in Japan. Very nice, but again, it's a little bit expensive. It's a little bit expensive to get this robot suits. When we developed such the things academically for the stroke patient, you know, hemiplegic patient like this, at the same time, we established a friendship society for stroke patient and families in 1981. The families, you know, they have a lot of problem, particularly after the patient return home, the families must take care of the patient. That's a big problem. Probably some of you know that, how difficult it is. In such a society, families, sometimes patients also join this conference to learn how to treat, how to take care of those patients at home. Sometimes we took them to one night tour for hot spring or sightseeing, something like that. It's easy to say, but actually it was very difficult to take these patients to the for the sightseeing using bus. You know, it's not so easy to take them to such a place. So at that night we had a dinner with a patient. So I always say to the patient, okay, please drink one or two cups of beer tonight, because your doctor is always staying with you tonight. So don't worry. So they feel very, very happy. And then there are, you see, there are some foreigners here. They came from Russia, and then they knew that such is a society, so they want to learn how is going to do. And then sometimes I took them to the foreign country. This is a tour to China. Well, it's easy to say that, to take the patient for foreign country, but actually, you know, they have to take airplane or something. And then the hotels in China, I'm sorry, management for the handicapped people, you know, cannot develop yet. So it was very difficult, but they feel very happy, because when they become stroke, all of them thought, okay, my life end. Well, they don't think they will have a foreign tour again in their life. Next, I'd like to talk about the vegetative state. I know this is the general data. There are 2 or 10 vegetative state patients per 100,000 persons. That depends upon the country. But this is the general instance of the vegetative state in the world. And then, as you know already, that there used to be no special treatment for vegetative state. The destiny of vegetative state patient Yes, we have spontaneous recovery, but it's around 5%. But 95% never improved and finally died at early stage. Around in 1980, there's one doctor, Professor Michael Keyes in UK. He developed new treatment for muscle rigidity, not vegetative, muscle rigidity using median nerve stimulation, not for vegetative state, like this. Upper limb, muscle rigidity. This is the video of Michael Keyes. You know, a patient has like such the rigidity. The right hand is very difficult to use for her. So such the device is implanted under the skin. And after the stimulation, she can do like this, although not so well yet. All the stimulating machine is implanted under the skin, like this. In a transplantation of this kind of machine, it's not big surgery. Not big surgery. I'm talking about comparing from the general neurosurgery. So in 1985, I have one patient, 60 years old, who had a stroke and right hand motor plegia, hemiplegia. So anyway, I tried to improve muscle rigidity of upper limb. But instead of the median nerve stimulation, I used dorsal column stimulation. The result, the patient did not show any improvement of muscle rigidity. However, patient became more smile, patient became more talk, and the patient became more active. So I thought, what it is? This is just the initial stimulation. Why I began to use dorsal column stimulation, spinal cord stimulation for vegetative state patient. All are implanted under the skin. The machine is like this. Maybe this machine was improved nowadays. The Professor Morita will tell you the recent tendency after my talk. This is the surgery. Surgery also will tell you by Professor Morita, but anyway, briefly I'll show you. This is again not a big surgery. All the stimulator is implanted under the skin. This stimulator goes to the neck. C2 level, epidural space. That epidural space, but if there are some neurosurgeon here, the epidural space surgery is not so difficult compared from intradural surgery. So all are implanted under the skin. But surgery is surgery. However, everything is done under the skin. So not so big surgery. maybe Professor Morita will tell you, it goes to C2 level epidural space. Epidural space, you know, simulator goes here. I'll show you several cases before and after. Before treatment, young boy, trauma. So-called complete vegetative state. This year started at 5 months. He improved dramatically. Another case, again, young boy, before the treatment, this year started 5 months. Then it took a long time after the stimulation, but anyway, the patient could do like this. Again, young boy trauma before the treatment looked bad, very typical vegetative state. This is before treatment. This was done at 12 months. And then this is after the treatment. Anyway, we could have some communication. Again, young boy, before treatment. Again, the clinical condition is completely in vegetative state. This year started at 26 months after trauma. This is after the stimulation. Anyway, he could have some communication with outside. Again, young boy, trauma before the treatment. He had a big surgery for trauma, hematoma. This is the condition before treatment. This year started 33 years after this accident. This is after treatment. Now, he can have some communication with outside. 3 years after, he came home and he's enjoying the TV game. Show you some more case. Again, young boy trauma before the treatment. 1 year after the trauma, he had been the same condition for 1 month before the treatment. No communication with outside. Six months after dorsal column stimulation, now he could have some communication with outside. One more case, trauma, before the stimulation. Again, he had been in vegetative state. This is 1 month after the stimulation. Not so dramatic improvement, but patient family became very much present. They feel happy. Another case, before the treatment? One month after the stimulation. Anyway, she can eat by herself. Probably the last case before the stimulation. Two months after the DCS, he improved rather quickly. Now he can eat Japanese noodle by using steak. So anyway, until my retirement, I had experienced 200 cases by this new treatment. At the first stage of this study, most of the effective cases could be seen in the trauma group, not so much in vascular or anoxic group. Particularly the younger patient can have much better, could have much better outcome by this new treatment. One of the most important indications at the first stage was RCBA. If it's more than 20 cc per 100 per minute, we have much more excellent cases. So this was the indication of the first stage of this new treatment, young and RCBF is more than 20 cc. Then we move on to the second stage of the study. We focused to do this treatment for young and the patient who has 20 cc of RCBF. Then the phase two study, the result became much improved. Not only the trauma case, vascular or some anoxic accident case also showed much improvement by this new treatment. So at the time, the indication was young, trauma, and RCBF more than 20 cc. This was the indication at the time. Maybe it has changed a little bit. Maybe Professor Morita will tell you the present condition. Anyway, I published some paper in PACE 1987 and also 1989 and also 2009 in modulation. I had so many Japanese papers. Why is sometimes it's effective for such a patient? You know, the improved case, the one of the eminent change before and after the treatment is RCBF. This is before the treatment, after the treatment. So RCBF is increased. This was reported by many authors, Hosobuchi, Meguryo, Professor Matsui, etc. Number two, spinal cord stimulation enhances glucose metabolism. It was also reported by several authors. Number three, some authors reported increased acetylcholine metabolism content after the stimulation increase. The neurotransmitter, also substance P, GABA, dopamine, they also increased. So action mechanism of this new treatment at that time increased RCBF, catecholamine metabolism increase, release, GABA increase, substance P increase, FDG increase, acetylcholine content also increase. So as a result, the EEG changed more active wave, alpha wave after this treatment, decreased the slow waves after this treatment. So when we establish this kind of new treatment academically, at the same time, I established Japan Coma Society in Japan in 1992. The members of this society, doctors, nurses, the governmental people, and then patient and patient family. This is the first Coma Society Congress. Most of the participants were doctors from all over the Japan. We had a very hot discussion like this among doctors at first. Then some nurses began to participate in this Congress. Now we had so many presentations from the nurse side. This is the second stage. And then I established Coma Society for patient and patient family again. This is not a stroke society. This is Coma Society in 1988. Nowadays we have 9 families in Japan. All of the members of this society is nearly 400. He is the president of this society. His son was also vegetative state. They sometimes gather like this, and then they learn how to treat the patient, how to take care of the patient at home. You know, this is one of the meetings like this. All members are the families of the patient. And then some specialists gave some lectures to them. And then they had a very hot discussion after this among them. Among them. All of the family of the vegetative patient. And nowadays, some families take the patient outside, for example, for some famous Japanese festival. It's easy to say, but actually it's not so easy for the patient family to take such patient to this festival. But they are trying to do this way. So among the families, they can promote the friendship among them. So they can give, they can receive some very good advice from other families. Sometimes they meet the governmental politician to support more and more for such kind of the society. At the same time, I also did support for, began to support for young doctors and nurses, mostly in the developing country, mostly in Asia. In 1993, 22 years ago, I invited 100 young neurosurgeons, but at the time there's no neurosurgical department in each country of Asia, but they are very much interested in neurosurgery. So we said neurosurgeon, but we invited 100 young neurosurgeons to our place. We provided travel fee, accommodation, everything from us. Oh, it was very expensive, but fortunately, Toyota company supported us a lot. Again, in 2007, when I had the World Congress of Neurosurgery at my place, I invited 247 young neurosurgeons, this time not from only Asia, but from Africa or Middle East. Again, we provided travel expense, accommodation, free registration, etc. Again, so much expense, but anyway, we could do it. This is a session for such a young neurosurgeon. You know the Professor Zami? Maybe neurosurgeon here are very well known. Actually, he's number one neurosurgeon in the world. And then I learned a lot of things from Professor Zami. But he also enjoyed us very much. And also, we began to exchange young with particularly developing country. When I retired, I invited 209 young neurosurgeons and nurses to my department. They did the same way with Japanese resident, like this is, you know, so-called professor's morning round. I don't know. Maybe you do the same way. But, you know, there are some foreigners here, but they did the same way with him. And we invited nurses from Asia, and some of them assisted my surgery when I did some difficult case, but they could do very well. When I did the surgery, many foreigners are watching my surgery in the operating theater. You know, all of them and the young doctors from the Asian countries. So now we are so-called Asian families. 22 years passed. So they become very great doctors in each country. Probably number one or number two neurosurgeon in each country. And then, of course, this activity was supported by the World Federation of Neurological Surgeons. So, some countries in Asia are changing very quickly. But still, some countries are very miserable condition like this. They could not have no treatment for vegetative state, of course, no treatment. No neuro rehabilitation yet. No right other patient. That's terrible for patient. So 4 years ago, I established MGO, like you. We say Japan International Medical Cooperation Organization. This is a member of this MGO. All of them, most of them are doctors, and then nurses and lawyers. Support for the developing country, mostly in Asia. I started the support from Myanmar. You know, nowadays you read the newspaper about the election of Myanmar. Mr. Aung San Suu Kyi got a victory. You know, this is the number of neurosurgeons in Myanmar, 15. In Japan, we had 10,000 recognized neurosurgeons. The big difference. This is CT and MRI. In Myanmar, 6 CT, 3 MRI, other country. Oh, we have so many in Japan. Big difference. And no health insurance in Myanmar. So expense for CT and MRI examination almost equal with 1 year income. This is a general neurosurgical ward in Myanmar General Hospital. That means the number one hospital in Myanmar, number one governmental hospital in Myanmar. This is a neurosurgical ward. Most of the patients have brain tumor, severe stroke, etc. That means patient cannot walk by himself, by themselves. That means they cannot go to the toilet by themselves. Everything must be done, treated on the bed. But can you see? There's no curtain around the bed. That means there's no privacy at all. And of course, there's no air condition. So it was terrible neurosurgical ward. This is highest national hospital in Myanmar. On the other hand, there are two or three so wonderful hospitals in Myanmar. Like this. This hospital is much better, much more beautiful than any Japanese hospital. And this hospital is mainly for very limited number of rich people, super rich patients, and also the military persons. So we began to support neurosurgical, to build neurosurgical center, rescue center in Yangon General Hospital by ODA, that means by the Japanese governmental support. This might be finished to build within next year. It takes huge money, but government supported us. Made the LOA MOU on Myanmar side. And then maybe you know that when we do NPO, NGO, we need the governmental support, particularly from the very strong politician. There are some neurosurgeons, there are some doctors, some researchmen here. But what we can do is very, very small. Neurosurgeon can do only very, very small surgery and et cetera, and then the talk at the conference and stuff. That's all. We cannot move the country and the people, not at all. So we are now getting support from Mr. Suga. This is the number two politician in Japan. Maybe you think the number one Prime Minister Abe is moving the Japan, but actually no. He is moving Japan and the Japanese society. So lastly, I'd like to say, through my such activity in my life, warm eyes for the weak people is very, very important, particularly for doctors and nurses. I have learned such things from two persons. One is Mr. Dalai Lama. I met him several times through the Eurasian Academy of Neurological Surgeon. Oh, he is a very great man. He taught us a lot about what the doctor should be. Another person is Mother Teresa. I have met her three times in India. You know what it is? This was her private room. C she had lived in this small room, more than 70 years. She received the Nobel Prize, you know. And then she is wearing the same dress throughout the year. So maybe not necessary to set up the cosmetic box or cosmetic table or dress box. That's why she could live in such a small room, more than 70 years. When I look at this room, I couldn't say anything. I got a lot of tears at the time. Anyway, in Japan also, this was about 70 years ago, Japan, just after the Second World War, there was nothing at all at the time. Nowadays, we developed to some extent, fortunately, but still we have so many problems. The true happiness and fortune exist in the heart, not in the pocket. This is very much important for myself, anyway. Well, thank you very much for your kind listening today. And then I'm. Thank you very much. You understand my poor English, but thank you very much. I got one message from my grandkids. They said, "Best regards, all the friends in Poland." Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Kano. Rzeczywiście ogromne wrażenie, myślę, na Państwa, na każdym z nas zrobiły te przykłady pacjentów i te spektakularne efekty zastosowania metody DCS, a więc stymulacji sznura tylnego. Pan profesor przedstawił kilka takich postaci, osób, które rzeczywiście widać wyraźnie, jak ta metoda jest skuteczna, ale też imponująca jest działalność pana profesora związana z budowaniem w ogóle świadomości wokół problemów, o których dziś dyskutujemy, także działalność związana z integracją środowiska neurochirurgów, no i wielkie serce do tego, aby pomagać tym, którzy takiej pomocy potrzebują, a pacjent jest zawsze w centrum zainteresowania.